Hi, everybody. My name is Tamar, and I run the distributed data systems team at Box. So that means we focus on database, cache, and messaging infrastructure. So today, I'm going to share with you guys a bit about the current state for our database and cache tiers, some of the somewhat unique choices that we've made in designing those systems, and also something that's a little bit different maybe for a technical talk. I'm actually going to share with you guys some of the challenges that we're facing today and some of the projects that we're actually working on now to address those. So at Box, we're building a way for you to share, manage, and access your content from any device, anywhere. This is actually a snapshot of my Box account. This is our Teams folder, so we have room for messaging, database, cache, our fun team photos, everything we need to be able to work effectively together. We have over 240,000 businesses that are using Box, and businesses are kind of our core focus area. We also have over 27 million users, and one number that I particularly like, we have over 6 billion API calls per month being made through third-party applications that are built on top of our platform. Now, this is just a small sample of the customers that are using Box, and if you look, you can see that there's a pretty big variety in terms of the type of industry and also the size of the business, so including some pretty big ones like Toyota or Procter & Gamble. So really, at all levels at Box, whether it's business or product or infrastructure, we have to think about how we cater to this diverse set of users. And really, when you think about building infrastructure for the enterprise cloud, you have kind of a unique set of challenges. So we all want our websites to be available. That's definitely not unique. But at Box, you know, a lot of our customers are actually integrating Box into their core critical business workflows. And so if we're down, that is having an immediate effect on their ability to do business. And this is something that we take very, very seriously and that feeds into some of the architecture and design decisions that we've made with our systems. Consistency is another important one. If I'm using Box to coordinate a globally distributed workforce, I need to know that everyone is seeing, you know, the same information and we can effectively work together. Now, I know that it's a little bit cheating to have both availability and consistency on a slide when talking about distributed systems, so obviously cap theorem still holds, but this is more about, you know, making those types of trade-offs and thinking about how it's going to impact our users. And then finally, another aspect of consistency is in how it pertains to security. So security is obviously very important in the enterprise space. From a database and cache perspective, we're really talking about the transactionality that you can have in making changes in your account, the guarantee of consistency that if you make a change to some permissions access control, that, you know, that will replicate in the right way to everyone it's relevant to. And so at a very high level, our core application data architecture looks kind of like this. And really with core data, what I'm talking about is sort of the metadata for our core objects. So users, enterprises, folders, files. And again, for files, it's just the metadata, not the file storage itself. So we have three main components here. We have our cache pool, which is in memcache. We have a combination of sharded and non-sharded MySQL, which makes up our application data store. And then orchestrating all of this, we have a custom data access layer, which is part of our PHP code base. So let's talk first a little bit about caching. And I feel like the previous talk has given us all a really good preparation for this. So we have a variety of use cases for caching at Box, including tracking rate limits and session information, and even some of the path optimization information for our upload and download accelerators. But really, the main usage is for these database-backed objects. So again, files, folders, users. And for these, we are managing it, as I mentioned, through our data access layer and using it basically as a demand-filled look-aside cache, which is pretty standard. We do have support for some interesting lookup methods, so both primary and secondary keys. And we also have support for versioning. So we actually put the versioning encoded as part of the value, which allows us to do things like rolling out new versions of code, referencing new versions of our model objects without compromising our cache consistency. So just to give you a rough idea of our scale, we have approximately 50 servers with 36 gigs of memory each. We're seeing 250K gets per second at peak, and we're actually getting an over 90% hit rate, which means that we're getting a lot of mileage out of our cache. Now, our main problem is exactly what was described in the previous session. So, you know, direct access, you can see that this is bad because it looks ugly. You know, if your architecture diagram doesn't look nice, then something's wrong. And so here you can see, for example, our PHP processes opening up direct connections to the memcache pool, the memcache servers that they need from the pool. And what's interesting is because the keys are spread out randomly across the different memcache servers, and because each PHP process actually needs to fetch, you know, upwards of 100 different keys during the course of its processing, then we're going to end up having a situation where these PHP processes have connections open to a large proportion of our pool. Now, obviously, this is a problem in terms of, you know, the number of connections against the boxes, and so that's a scalability concern. But there's another aspect in here, and it was mentioned in the previous slide, you know, one cache server goes down, you can have an outage. So that one's a little less trivial to understand. So imagine that we have just one memcache server that goes down. And you'd think, you know, this is just a proportion of our overall pool. It should have a proportional effect. The problem is we have all of these different PHP requests that are trying to access that server. And again, this is not an insignificant proportion of the total requests that are running. And all of these guys start slowing down, right? Because they need to try to connect to the server. Maybe they're waiting for a timeout. If they do figure out that something's wrong, they're going to fall back to accessing the database, which is even slower. And so overall, all of these requests are now taking a longer time to complete. While they're taking a longer time to complete, they're holding their connections open to the rest of the pool. And so slowly, connections start building up across the entire memcache tier, and they all start having trouble. And what's even worse than this is that the same pattern happens against your databases, because, again, these same processes are holding open connections to your database servers as well. And what's especially sort of counterintuitive is the fact that if you add additional servers, not only does it not help, it actually makes things worse, because now there's a larger chance that one of these boxes is going to fail, and you haven't really addressed the core cascading problem. So we're working on a new cache clustering architecture of our own called Tron. And Tron is going to give us three main things. So automatic failure detection, a central brain for coordinated decisions. And this was sort of mentioned in the previous talk as well. But it's really important for us to make sure that if we are making a decision that, you know, one of the servers is not in a healthy state and we want to fail over to a spare, that we're doing that in a coordinated fashion so that we have a consistent cache. So if clients are making these determinations locally based on their own view of the cluster, you can very easily get into this split brain situation where some of the clients are working with one memcache server while others are working with a different one, and, you know, you have stale values in your cache. And again, with our focus on consistency being very critical to us, we had to go with an architecture that had a more coordinated failure approach. And then also, this allows us to control and limit the number of connections against the boxes. So this is sort of a very similar architecture to what we just saw for McRouter. So we have a memcache proxy running locally on all of our client boxes. And so the clients basically connect to it as if it was a memcache server. It responds to the same API. And then these memcache proxies are the ones that make the actual connection to the memcache servers themselves. So again, managing the number of open connections. Now, whenever they identify that one of the servers is having trouble, they actually notify the cache manager. So the cache manager, that's our central brain. This is a Scala service that is entrusted with figuring out the overall health of the system. So it's collecting errors that it's getting from all of the proxies. It's also going directly to the cache servers themselves and collecting various health checks and other statistics and feeding all of it into a rule engine. And the rule engine is what determines, you know, do we actually have a failure of a memcache server, or is it a specific client box that's having trouble connecting? If the cache manager does decide to make a change in configuration, then it creates a new conf pulling in a spare, pushes that to ZooKeeper, and then all of the proxies pull down the new configuration, and in a space of a very short amount of time, the entire cluster fails over to the spare cache server. Okay, so moving on to our application data tier. So as I mentioned before, combination of sharded and non-sharded MySQL managed by that same PHP data access layer. We have this layer basically gives us support for shard resolution. It also manages the caches that we were looking at before. We enable various ways to fetch your data, including sorting, filtering, limiting. It allows us to build kind of a more rich feature set in our product. We also support transactions in shard, and this is very important to kind of give our developers a really powerful tool, again, to build in that consistency and those guarantees. And we also enable reading from slaves in a way that guarantees read consistency, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So especially for these last three, you can see that we're really leveraging MySQL capabilities at the per node level to give a more robust data infrastructure for our developers to leverage. Again, just to give you an idea of our scale, so we have approximately 50 application shards. We're seeing 100K queries per second at peak, and we're storing over 30 terabytes of data. And again, this is our metadata. The file storage is a lot more. Okay, so in terms of our sharding approach, what we're doing is we're actually partitioning by enterprise. And this is very important because, first off, it allows us to give those strong consistency and transactional guarantees because, again, we do support that behavior at the per node level. It also gives us an easier way to guarantee the availability for an enterprise because if you think about it, they're now dependent on a smaller footprint of hardware within our overall cluster. And finally, it does give us the ability to tune performance and quality of service for some of our larger deployments if we choose to do so. To enable this, we actually keep an object to shard mapping in another data store, which is our mapping DB. Part of the reason for that is that enterprise is not actually denormalized against all of this content, and so we have to keep that extra mapping so that we can co-locate content in the way that we want. And in fact, every object can be looked up according to a set of keys, not just one. These are called the mapping keys. So for a file object, you could imagine that we could look it up by the file ID, the parent folder, the user. All of those things will tell us where this file is going to be located in our databases. And that access layer automatically analyzes queries that it gets to find the appropriate mapping keys to use and then goes and looks up the right shard to run it against. So all of that aspect is abstracted away. And finally, we have this very bizarre use case, which I'm still to find someone else who's had to handle this particular one. But we can actually have a situation where we need to move data between shards in response to some user action, so not as a maintenance operation that we run in the background. If I have a file and I choose to move it to one of my collaborators, which is something I'm allowed to do, and that collaborator happens to be in another enterprise that's mapped to a different shard, in order to maintain that sharding environment, I'm now actually going to have to take the data and move it between database servers, which is a pretty intense process, but again, another thing that's taken care of by our data access layer. So I've kind of glossed over this very quickly. If you are interested in learning a little bit more details about how we decided to partition our data, how we rolled it out, then you can check out this talk, which is also available online. OK, so I mentioned before that we enable reading from slaves as well. And so for every master database that we have, we also have a few slaves that are available for it. And generally, they're lagging under a second, although we do sometimes see spikes of higher lag due to replication load. So they generally remediate very, very quickly, but it does kind of spike up and then go back down. We are in the process of moving to MySQL 5.6 so that we can turn on parallel replication, which if you're running in a sharded environment can be very useful. There's also a bunch of other interesting features in 5.6 that we're looking forward to. So we have two main modes of reading from slaves. The first one is lag insensitive. This basically means I'm OK with reading data that's a little bit stale if the slave database server is generally up and running, then I'm okay to access it. And honestly, we don't actually leverage this all that much because, again, in most cases, we do require a higher guarantee of consistency. So for that, we have the second type of access, which is lag sensitive. So here, as part of the request, we actually pass in a master position, or basically a checkpoint, which is a point in time that we care about, and we'll only execute against the slave if it's caught up to that point at least. If not, we're going to fail the request. Now, this might seem a little bit aggressive, but it actually guarantees a level of consistency, right? If this is, say, I made some change, and now I want to kick off some processing job that needs to be able to see that change, then by using this type of access pattern, I'm guaranteed to have it be consistent. And it works really well for asynchronous jobs. So you can imagine, again, making some sort of change, grabbing a checkpoint, kicking off an asynchronous job. By the time it gets to process, probably the slave is caught up and we'll be able to run it. If not, it gets it fails, and then our job management system will actually automatically retry it a little bit later, at which point the slave will probably be caught up. Okay, so some of our top-of-mind challenges on the database tier. So first off, again, direct access is a huge problem when you start hitting larger scale. We really can't protect the database from traffic surges, which is definitely one of the things that keeps me up at night. And also the problem of high volume of connections, especially as it pertains to kind of a cascading problem. So even if you've configured your pool of servers to be okay for your current load, if you have this, you know, one part of the system that starts getting wonky, things start taking longer, connections start stacking up, and this can become a pretty hard problem. And also, it's with direct access, it's a lot harder to reroute in-flight requests if you want to fail over either planned or in response to an outage. The second challenge that we have is that our data access tier is actually written in PHP. And so, you know, writing a data store in a dynamically typed language is an interesting exercise. We have actually built a pretty interesting project in-house at Box called Augmented Types, which lets you annotate your PHP code, and then it actually does type checks in runtime if you want. And we do use this particularly in our testing environments, but it's still, you know, it's not a perfect system. But this isn't a project that we've open sourced if it's of interest to you. Memory and performance on PHP, also not that great. We are working on moving to HHVM, so we're excited about that, but still. And there's no native parallelism in PHP, so we can't really take advantage. If we are making multiple queries against more than one shard, we can't execute those in parallel, which is a shame. And finally, it's not client agnostic. So as you've seen, even in this current state that we're in, we've built a lot of interesting functionality into this access layer, but it's baked into our PHP code base. And you know, over time, we've had more and more other types of clients that we want to be able to support. In particular, we now have a bunch of backend services written in Scala, and none of them can you know, cleanly take advantage of the infrastructure that we've built because it's part of our web app code base. So what we're working on the database team is our new scalable relational data store, which we're calling Credence. It abstracts sharding, caching, transactions, read-only slaves, all of the things I've mentioned and more. And this is really what enables it to be client agnostic, because if you think about it, we're taking all the complexity out of our PHP client, we're pulling it out into a separate service, which means that the remaining client is actually very simple, and it's a lot easier to maintain one of those in any language that we need. Whereas re-implementing all of this and maintaining it actively in more than one code base or more than one language would be quite heavy, especially for the size of team we have. Credence is also going to be a place to perform health checks and do failover in case we identify a server is having trouble. And again, it gives us an ability to control and limit our connections. So again, at a high level, this is what the architecture looks like. From whatever client you're using, be it PHP or Scala, instead of connecting directly to the database tier, you're connecting to a Credence box, making your request there. And then Credence is maintaining open connection pools, basically, against the various database servers and responding to your request. So taking on the task of taking your data access layer, creating it or moving it from kind of running inline to being a separate service, and then also changing it from PHP to Scala is a pretty intense undertaking. And so we've taken a very incremental approach to our development and deployment. The first phase, which we've already completed, we have the bottommost part, which enables us to connect to the databases and actually execute queries. And we have a very simple, it's almost like a pass-through API to MySQL. It takes a SQL query and a name of a database, and it executes your query against that database. So even at this level, we still get the benefits of connection pooling, traffic rerouting, transactions, read-only slaves. And there are a few sort of complex query use cases that we have, which this is useful for. The second phase, which is what we're working on now, starts adding a little bit more of sophistication in. So here, what we're introducing is the notion of schema and the notion of sharding. And so you can execute a query, which is now, it's still SQL-esque. It's a little bit more structured and a little narrower. So it's the subset of SQL that we support against our sharded architecture. And this is useful to us for some health check tools and scripts where they don't necessarily need that full-blown object relational type access, but they still don't want to have to deal with sharding directly. And then our overall vision for where we want to take this and the next thing we're going to be working on is an object-based API. This is going to be very similar to the way that data is accessed currently in our PHP code base. And one of the main advantages here is that it's going to leverage our caching tier. And so this is what we envision our core data access and user-facing flows to be using. Now, one of the interesting things is we still have a pretty big open question as to how we're going to support transactions in this model. We do have a couple of options that we're thinking about, but definitely when you introduce a level of indirection between your client and your database server, then transactions become more of a question as to how you want to handle that. Okay, so a few closing thoughts. I think you've seen this kind of as a theme in a lot of the talks today. Anything your infrastructure doesn't support, your developers are going to have to account for every time they use it. And in our case, and I think in the case for a lot of you guys, developers means, you know, the in-house engineers that are building on top of the infrastructure that you're developing, any third-party engineers that are building on top of your external platform, if you have one like we do. And then, of course, if you're open sourcing your code, what is someone who uses your project going to get from it? And you can't do everything, right? You have to choose those trade-offs wisely. And so I think the key that really drives us is trying to figure out how to build an infrastructure that makes what you value easy. And so you've heard from other people in other talks here how, you know, maybe the most important thing is performance or latency or throughput. For us, you know, three main themes are, again, availability kind of at that enterprise level, consistency, security, so building in things like transaction support and a special flavor of reading from slaves in a consistent way have been really useful tools for our developers to then be able to leverage as they're building their code. So before I wrap up, I did want to take this opportunity to invite you guys. We are hosting an open source open house on September 23rd. There's going to be a couple of talks, and then there's also going to be representation from a bunch of companies who are doing interesting things in the open source community. And so if you're interested in hearing more about what all of these companies are up to, it is a free event, so you're welcome to register online. In general, if you're interested in learning more about some of the projects that we're working on in engineering at Box, you can check out our blog. The developer site has information on our platform. And then if you want to check out some of the projects that we've open sourced, they're all aggregated under that open source website, including the augmented types project that I mentioned before, and also a bunch of pretty useful database tools that we've built as well, if that's of interest. So that's all I have. And I think I have time for a question. Yeah? Anyone have any questions? Thank you.